about the right category, we learn what the T structure is. So finally, we can talk about Bridgeland stability. So let me start with, let me recall briefly what we did last time. So where we are so far. So we know what the stability on an abelian category is. And we're going to generalize slightly today in a second. And then we learned what dB of A is. Actually, we learned what dB of X is. Let me just recall the notation, which is dB of cox. Okay? And then we learned what the heart of a T structure is. Okay, so that's the three things we do. Now, let me start with the first thing. So I want to give a general definition. And unfortunately, it's slightly technical, a part of it. I'm going to slow about it. So let's see. So Bridgeland stability. There is a first slightly technical part, which is the following. So I start as before. So let me start with X smooth projective over the complex numbers, always over the complex number. So the first thing I want to do, I want to look at, let me just change slightly notation. Let me look at the Grote and the group. Okay, so this we know what it is. So this is just the group generated by classes of sheaves or a vector bundle. Let me say sheaves is the same thing. And then you mod out by the relations given by E minus A minus B whenever you have an exact Grote group as we know in coherent sheaves of the following form. Okay, so that's the technical part is the following. This guy is huge, so I want to cut it slightly. So let me fix a map once and for all. And I'll tell you later which maps I will want. But I want to fix a surjective map from the Grote group into a finite rank lattice. So lambda is a finite rank lattice. A good thing to keep in mind, although we're going to play a bit with this lambda a bit later, a good choice, for example, is cohomology, okay? Or some numerical groups. Okay, so definition. Once we have that one, now we can define what a Bridgeland stability is. So a Bridgeland stability condition is actually general. You can define it on any triangulated category, but let me just do in dbx. Is the following data. So generally, it's denoted by sigma. And to on dbx, za, I will tell you what there are. So what is a? Let's start with a. So a is a heart inside dbx of a bounded T structure, as we saw yesterday. Okay, so that's just the datum, so it's the abelian category. And now Z, I want to induce a stability on the abelian category as we saw yesterday. So the second data are two functions, R and D. But now instead of going into the whole object, I'm asking that I factor through lambda. But doesn't matter so much. So this is a function, it goes into R. This is a function as well into R, such that which are group homomorphism, such that the following thing happens. So it's just a stability in the sense of what I told you before. So I want the following. I want that if I take R and I apply it to V of A, this guy is positive. And if R of V of A is equal to 0, then I want the degree is positive. So this means that these two functions are just exactly what we saw before, and where A is an element in my heart. Okay, so I just want on the heart. Okay, so that's exactly as we saw yesterday. Okay, just a repetition of what we saw yesterday. And the only thing that might be a good comment is that somehow V of A, I'm seeing as an object in A. So the key here is the following, is that if I have a heart, then it's not so hard to see that if I take the Grothendieck group of this category A now, this is the same as the Grothendieck group of X. Okay. So now this makes sense because I take an object in A, I move it here by the inclusion, and then I can apply V here. So I go into lambda, and then I map into the map. Okay? So that makes sense now. Okay? And that's the same as before. So what is Z now? Z is generally, it's a notation now. It's just a negative degree plus square root of minus 1, the rank. And so it is a function which goes from lambda into the complex numbers now. Okay? And this is called the central charge. And then the same thing as last time. So we ask cardinal Zeeman filtration to exist. Okay? So that's just what we saw. And now there is a last condition, which is the following. Some of you actually remarked me yesterday, somehow in our definition for coherent sheaf on a curve, we also have Jordan Holder filtrations. So these are not automatic, and it's not quite enough to ask that they exist. You have to ask if they exist locally. And so this is another condition which is slightly technical, but it will be fundamental for everything we do today and in the next two times, is the following property number 4, which is called support property. And what it means, okay, this might be a bit obscure at the moment, but this says the following thing. It says that there exists a non-degenerate quadratic form Q on our lattice lambda tensor rod over R, such that I have the following two conditions. So if I can look at the rank and the degree, and I can take the kernel of both of them, so intersect the two kernels. And what I want the following two options. I want the Q restricted to the kernel of both of them. So let me write the kernel of Z. So the kernel of both of them, I want to be negative definite. Okay, so this is a quadratic form. I restrict to the subspace of codimension 2. I want it to be negative definite. And the second condition, I want the following. I want that I have a notion of stability in my abelian category. I can speak about semi-stable objects. And so what I want that Q on semi-stable objects to be positive. Okay? So it seems obscure, this thing. We are going to see later why it works. But I'll try to convince you that this is fundamental property for doing two things. For deforming stability, and for actually proving existence of stability. So it comes in two forms, and I'm going to describe them today. Yes?
About the property of the rank, when
yeah.
Is
it exactly?
So
this one?
Well, it begins with A, begins yeah.
To A minus 0, yeah.
Is it for all A?
For all A, yeah. I want that for all A, I want that the rank to be positive. And if the rank is 0, then the degree I want it to be positive. I want R and D such that the rank in positive and, I'm sorry, I should have added more word. And if blah, then blah. I'm sorry. Thanks. Okay, so it's the same as we saw yesterday anyway, right? So that's the same definition and the same for curves, everything. The only different thing is that there's an annoying condition there, which is going to come into picture. Let me just make a remark. For curves, this Q does not exist. You can take Q equal to 0. Okay? Because for Q, our lambda will be two-dimensional, and the kernel will be the kernel of rank and degree, it's just 0. So there is no object which has rank and degree equal to 0, except the 0 object. So this thing is easy to check. Somehow this is obvious. And this guy, then, if you take 0, it's 0. So it's fine. Okay, so for curves, this thing does not exist. That is a typical surface thing.
Yeah.
It's canonical given by this embedding. Because how do you do? So here you take an object, you put it here, so it's a complex. So you extend, you write it in cohomology, and then the cohomology take the class inside the Grothendieck group of X with plus minus sign according to where they are set. So that's the map.
It's
part of the definition somehow. It's actually, I should have said, somehow it's such a thing, and there exists also such. Yeah, okay, it's not unique. It's not unique. Somehow you can yeah, somehow it's, you just ask that such a queue exists. Yeah, it's not unique, and there is choices actually, and that's like indeed the problem actually. We'll see. Yeah. Yeah. It's no, it's not true. It's okay. Let me tell you. The idea that you have to think about this thing is the discriminant, and so this is Bogomolov inequality for sheaves on surfaces, and that's actually what it is. Okay. So it's not an if and only if, but some, okay. Yeah. Maybe if you find something refined, yeah. But in general, no, it's not. Mm. Yeah. Okay. So let's try. One, okay, to arrive to the example is not so easy. Let me first state the theorem, although I'm not going to prove it, but I'm going to show you in an example, at least, how this theorem goes. But so the theorem of Bridgeland, the main theorem, which is, let me first say a notation. Let me call stab of x the set of Bridgeland stability conditions. This is a set. And so the first remark that there is a natural topology in it. I didn't say what. I don't want to define it, but I will see later what this topology is, at least in an example. So this tab becomes a topological space. And so the main theorem of Bridgeland is that it's a complex manifold. And I'll tell you also how it works. So Bridgeland's deformation theorem. So it's telling you the following thing. It's telling you that this tab is, so if I consider the map Z from the space of stability conditions into the space of group homomorphisms between my lattice lambda and C, and what I do, I just take Z and the heart, and I'm just forgetting the heart. Okay. And the key theorem here is that this guy is a local homomorphism. Okay, with respect to this natural topology. So what it means the following thing. So this is the hard part. So if you take Z, which comes from a stability condition, and you deform slightly the Z, then you can find the hard, which works. And the key thing for doing this thing is this property here. I'm trying to explain a bit later in an example, but that's the key here to do. Okay, so in particular, from this theorem, you get the following thing. You get that the stab is a complex manifold of dimension equal to the rank of our lattice lambda. Okay, so that's the theorem. We'll see later. Okay, the example, let me just do this just to finish with curves. Then I will not touch curves anymore. But the example is the following. So if I start with a curve of genus greater or equal than 1, P1 is slightly more different. And it seems interesting, but P1 is slightly more interesting. But anyway, then you get the following thing. You get that the space of stability conditions is nothing but, as a complex manifold, is the upper half plane cross C. Yeah, and lambda is what? I said before, but lambda is the following. It's H0C direct sum H2CZ. Okay? So it's Z2. And the map V is nothing but rank and degree. Okay? So V is nothing but rank and degree. Okay, so that's standard, and Q, what it is, Q is zero, as I said before. Because I'm happy, right? Because the kernel is zero, and semi-stable, then it's fine.
So it's not a non-degenerate.
Okay, you can take, sorry, okay. You can destroy, yeah, I just ask the non-degenerate. Take, thanks. No, careful, yeah, this identification is not via the rank and degree. I'm sorry, I'll tell you. Identification is different. No, sorry. Okay, so these are separate things. This identification, I can tell you how it works. It's actually not so hard. So this guy is the following. You have to think about, so Let me tell you an example of so an example, we know what it is. It's just standard slope stability. So A is coherent chi from C, A0. And Z0 is just minus degree plus square root of minus 1 rank. OK, so that's my first stability condition. And the interesting thing is the following, is that that's it. So this theorem is telling you that take this guy. Now what you can do with this stability, you can rotate the Z. And somehow you can imagine the category rotate as well, somehow. And there is a precise notion of this. There is an action of GL2R, or better, the universal cover. And that's it. There is nothing else. So all stability is just slope stability for curves. OK, so that's the idea here. So this is the identification. OK. Sorry? Yeah. Thanks. I'm sorry. Yeah. OK, so that's identification. No, there is no connection between these two. No. Thanks. And yeah, to connect to some of the interesting thing is that somehow, yeah, you cannot say much. You can say something more if the curve is elliptic. And if the curve is elliptic, is actually something which you saw it in Sam talk, the first talk. What you get exactly what you expect. So this has to be something like related to the moduli space of elliptic curve. So if C has genus 1, then you can do the following thing. You can take the space of stability conditions. And it's not so hard to see that there is an action by C. As I told you, the action by C is just multiplication by a complex number up to exponential. And then you can look at another group acting on this, which is a group of out equivalence of the derived category, which preserve the triangulated structure. And you can prove that this quotient is exactly what you expect. OK, so somehow this seems a sort of C star bundle over this space. OK, so that's one observation. And that's it, essentially. P1 is slightly more interesting, as I said, because P1 has, you can vary stability on P1. Here there is no variation stability, but on P1 there is some variation. Although it's trivial, but still, it's already the skeleton of something which is more interesting somehow. Okay, good. So that's curves. Okay, I will, that's all fine. Now let's go to surfaces. And so what I want to prove that also on surfaces, this theorem, I'm not going to prove it, as I said, but I'm going to show you on surfaces exactly what it is, this theorem, OK? By describing essentially an open subset of the space of stability conditions.
Excuse me.
Sure.
Why should be natural that stability conditions are in correspondence with
somehow we will see later. Somehow we don't see. But somehow the idea is that somehow technically, this guy is some sort of, so it should be dual, some sense, some mirror to the complex deformation. Should be the space which is mirror to the complex deformation. Should be identified in somehow to the space of complex deformation of the mirror. So in this case, an elliptic curve is just an elliptic curve. So this is the space of complex parameters, the moduli of elliptic curves. In general, it's not quite true, but in general, you expect to have at least an inclusion. So if you take a variety, you take the mirror, then you expect to have an inclusion from the complex deformation of the mirror into the space of stability conditions. But this statement is really not proved in any possible way, except in a few examples. For example, K3 surfaces of Picard 1, this is actually true. But and some local case is also true. But those are essentially it. But the reason is, it's coming from mathematical physics.
And for
in your remark, it's only Calabi-Yau case, of course, in KD trivial. And for each stability condition, you have a moduli space. But in this case, there is nothing. So it's always the same as slope stability. So they're all the same. So there is no variation. The moduli space of semi-stable objects are always going to be the moduli space of vector bundles on a curve. So there is no variation here.
Yeah.
In general, no. Yeah, and that's what we're going to see. Yeah. That's next tomorrow class. Yeah.
Is that in the sense that they're literally the same, or there's just no wall?
There is no wall. They're literally the same, actually. They're literally somehow. There is really no. There is no wall. But also there is somehow. They're literally somehow. When I do this action that I told you by matrices, I just essentially change the z. But the stable objects somehow they maybe have a different slope, but they all move with the same slope. So they're really the same object. So every object which is stable in this stability condition is a vector bundle which is stable. So and semi-stable, semi-stable. Yeah. So that's that exactly. Mm.
Yes, yeah. We are saying that for curves, basically lambda is unique.
Is this? Yeah, essentially is unique. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, essentially that's essentially the only. Somehow you can take something bigger actually a priori, but at the end of the day, I think you can show that there is nothing else somehow. In any case, even if you increase it.
This is not clear to me.
Ah.
One in principle can take lambda.
You can take the whole Grothendieck group, right? Mm-hmm. So that's infinite. That's huge, but not so huge, but still, that's fine. But still, somehow, maybe that will going to touch a bit your z, but still the stable object will still be the same somehow. Mm-hmm. So that you will not change you anything, unfortunately.
Yeah, the main thing is that the
yeah, it's if it's going to yeah, that's correct.
Yeah.
So there is nothing, yeah. But as you expect, right? Because somehow, as I said in the theorem, this guy essentially fixed the determinant. It's Picard 1. So you don't expect any rational geometry out of them.
My point is, you said, okay, this space has the same dimension as lambda.
As lambda, yeah, but.
So if you enlarge lambda, it's not exactly this, the situation.
Well, in this case, it's just for this lambda. You have some option to choose z a bit bigger, of course, yeah. Mm-hmm. But still, the stable object will be the same. Yeah, so that will be still identical thing.
So in general, the space of stability condition depends on...
On lambda, actually, yeah. To be precise, since Ciro, I think it's somehow to be precise, you have to write stub lambda if you want. Stub lambda somehow. Stub depends also on lambda. I fix lambda. Yeah. I fix lambda.
If you change lambda, take lambda
larger. Yeah.
Then it changes the dimension of the modulus.
Yeah, but you have to be. That's correct. But you have to be somehow. You also need this condition to be satisfied, right? Uh-huh. Yeah. So then it becomes a bit more subtle, right?
Right.
Then you have to worry about something. In this case, I have to think about it. Generally, you think always about this lambda, yeah. But, okay, let me think. In this case, I have to think about this. Because these conditions are slightly subtle in that becomes, right? Because the kernel becomes bigger, so you have to worry about this Q.
This forces lambda to be exactly this. Yeah.
Ah, sorry, I understand another question. I don't think it's written anywhere. I think I don't know at the moment. But on the other hand, the only thing I know is what I told you before, that in any case, even if you enlarge the thing, if you're just in the moduli space, there is nothing else. Yeah, so that's the only thing. But in general, yeah, you're right. Yeah, no, I agree with you. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
So can you replace k naught of x by cohomology?
In general, yeah, you can, but somehow there is no, essentially, it's similar to Ciro's question. Somehow you don't have really a canonical choice. And we are going to choose one later on, but there is really no canonical lambda that you get a priori. Yeah, neither minimal. You'll see later somehow. It's in a bit. So no, there is no canonical choice. No. Although one canonical. Yeah, Bridgeland in his paper choose numerical K theory, which is fine. But you can choose Hochschild cohomology, which seems a bit more natural. But I don't know somehow. There is not really no canonical. Yeah. Mm. Okay, other questions? Okay, good. So now let's go to surfaces, and you will probably see better this condition, actually. But first I need to do one thing, which is always a bit annoying, which is the notion of tilt. So let's do this tilt. So that's, we talked yesterday about this thing. And so that's the only way to construct hearts, once you have a heart, you can construct a new heart. So this is the procedure of tilting. So I forgot my counting, I think it's 8. So, and this is fundamental for later. So how does it go? It goes the following. So I start with a heart inside any category, actually. Well, let's say db of x. And so what I do the following. I have a small, I consider what's called a torsion pair. And I'll give you an example in a second. So a torsion pair is the following. Is a pair of additive subcategories, not necessarily abelian. So T and F are inside A and are additive. And the second condition is the following, is that the way to think about this, think about coherent sheaves, think about torsion sheaves, and think about torsion-free sheaves. Okay? So these are additive, and there is no morphism between torsion and torsion-free. Okay? That's the first condition. And the second condition is that every coherent sheaves is an extension of torsion and torsion-free. And so for all element A in A minus 0, there exists an element TA in T, and there exists an element FA in F, and an exact sequence, which is 0, goes to TA, goes to A, goes to FA, goes to 0. Okay, so I call such a thing a torsion pair. So the example is coherent, torsion, and torsion-free. That's not an interesting example. We're going to see one slightly more interesting later. But there are also more crazy torsion pairs somehow. It's this thing, it's, for example, on P1, even on curves anyway. You can just take a skyscraper sheaf of a point, and that will be a torsion pair given by itself and all the rest. So that's, anyway. But the lemma is the following. So the lemma, which is essentially lemma due to Appel. No, I want a sheaf, torsion, torsion-free. Right, yeah, so that's the... Sorry? Yeah, then TA is 0. So it's a binocular graph. That's an example. Okay, so the statement is following, which actually is elementary statement. So you say the following thing, but it's the only construction that essentially works. So if I start with a torsion pair, then I can construct a new category. And the new category, I call it A sharp, let's say. So this category is as follows. So it's a set of your complexes in dbx, such that. So what I do the following thing. So I can take a complex. I can look at the cohomology object with respect to A. So I can filter with respect to A and look at its cohomology. And so what I want that HAI of the complex to be equal to 0 for all I different from 0 minus 1. I'll give you an example in a second, something more concrete. And then H0, I want it to be in T. And H minus 1, I want it to be in F. And the statement is that once I start with a heart, this is also a heart. Okay. So the key here is to find the right torsion pair to get some interesting heart here. And the proof of this lemma, as I said, it's an exercise. It's some of the interesting is the notion, but the proof is not so hard. How do you do? You do it exactly how by checking the definition that we gave you yesterday. So check that there are no negative homes, and this is exactly what this condition comes about. And you check that everything can be written as an extension, and again, this comes from this thing here. Okay. And generally, to denote this guy, you have to think it as follows. So this is an extension of the torsion-free part in degree minus 1, and the torsion part in degree 0. So that's what it is. So something is in degree minus 1 becomes torsion-free, and the part in torsion stays where it stays. OK? Good. So let's see the example now. So the example is the following. So, and then someone said sort of, as I said, it's very surprising that this construction gives you something interesting, but it does.
So the homology you are taking is with respect to the
A. Okay. So this means the following.
New structure. structure.
The new structure, yeah. That's correct. So I'll give an example for coherent sheaves. So that's why I don't want to define this thing. But we defined it yesterday. So if you take the notion of this structure of Hart, any complex can be written as an extension of triangles in which you have all these elements. Those are the cohomology. Okay, those belongs to AKI, so that is HKI. But I will give an example for coherent sheaves in any case, so that's the same. Okay, good. Thanks. So surfaces. Okay, so that's the last thing I want to do today. So hopefully it's fine. And let me just say here, so this is all due to Bridgeland. And this idea that you have to use Bogomolov is in a paper by Arcara and Bertram. But some of the main idea was all to Tom. So let me do as follows. So I start with the X, a smooth projective surface. Okay, so it's dimension 2. And we know coherent sheaf don't work. So what I do the following thing. So here's a bit technical notation. So I fix an ample class, first of all, on X, which it's real. I'm allowing it to be real. Okay, so it's a real ample divisor. And then fixing any element B, which is just an element in the Neron severity of X, again with real coefficients. Okay, so these are two divisors, one example. Those are my parameters that I'm using in describing the space. So now next, there's a notion I need to find what torsion pair is. And so what I do, I start with coherent sheaves. But before doing that, let me just introduce a slide notation, which is the following. So I'm looking at slope stability with respect to omega and b. So what it means the following thing. I'm defining this function slope as follows, as plus infinity if the rank is 0. And I'm defining as degree over rank with some constant in front. Otherwise, where this C1 beta, what it is nothing, although later will come important. At the moment, it's just a translation, so this doesn't do anything. This is the usual slope stability. The only difference is that for notation, CH beta is the following thing. It's just you take the usual churn character and you dot with the formal exponential in minus beta. So let me just write it since it's a surface. So the rank is still the rank. It's not touched. The C1 changes, but changes just by a constant, which is B times the rank. And the CH2 changes as follows. Okay, so that's just a notation, nothing special. And this slope is going to induce a usual notion of slope stability on sheaves that we saw the first time, or the second times. And the constant B is irrelevant. It's just a constant which is an overall constant. Okay? So this gives a usual notion of slope stability. With respect to omega on torsion free sheaves. Okay.
Did you want to write
C2
down there instead of
CH2? Sorry, repeat again?
The third spot there.
Here? Yeah.
You have churn classes everywhere else, but.
Right. C1, I wrote a CH1. Sorry, thanks. Yeah, sorry, thanks. They are the same, actually, but still. Thanks. Yeah, thanks. Okay, good. Thanks. Great. So what do I do now? Let's define a torsion pair. And so the torsion pair is the following. So I define the torsion part by doing the following thing. So this is a notion of stability on sheaves. So I'm starting with coherent sheaves. And so what I do, I just take harder Riemann filtration with respect to this slope. Okay? And then I declare torsion part, all the one whose all harder Riemann factors, a slope which is positive, and the torsion free, the one which are negative. So the torsion part is the following. So is the E, which are in coherent sheaves, such that all hardened as Eman factors. Okay, sorry. Of E torsion free have slope mu omega b greater than zero. Okay, so I'm allowing torsion. So torsion sheaves are here. All torsion sheaves are inside this category. And I'm looking at the torsion free part. And I want that with respect to slope stability, I want that all factors, they have to have slope positive. Okay, so I'm just cutting it in that way. And f is the analog. So I want the same thing. I want the E such that E is torsion free. And all HN factors, blah, 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 have slope, blah, 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 mu omega b smaller or equal than zero. OK? So that's my definition of FMT. And so let's check the properties. So these are both inside coherent sheaves. OK. So they are additive. Direct sum works. And what I have to check? I have to check that the homes between... Oopla. Okay, so the first condition we checked. The second condition, I want the homes between T and F to be equal to zero. But that's true by stability, right? If I have something torsion, it will never map into something torsion-free. And if I have something torsion-free with slope positive, will never map into something with slope negative. Okay? So the second condition is checked. And the last condition, what it is again the existence of arrhythmia filtrations. So if I take something which is a coherent sheaf, I first factor out the torsion part, as we did. And then the torsion-free part, I take the arrhythmia filtration, and I just cut it in the middle. Okay? And one piece is here, and the rest is here. Okay? So that's why this thing is a torsion pair. Okay, so that's not too hard. Okay, and then I can tilt. I can just do this formal procedure, and then construct a new category. And so that's our category that we is going to work in the case of surfaces. But we have to worry about it, how this thing goes. This works for any variety. That's correct. Somehow at the end, somehow you can just generalize this omega to something, and you get the new category exactly the same way, exactly the same way. And we're going to talk about in the last class about this thing. So for threefold, for example, this works. And still, it's not a Bridgeland stability, but it's still useful to study, for example, Hilbert scheme of curves. Yeah, so something can be said about. Yeah, but we'll see in the last. But for the moment, for Bridgeland stability, only for surfaces this category will work. For threefold, you have to do something else. The harder as it. So yeah, if I. Yeah, in the middle means at when the slope B is equal to zero. So I'm taking a sheaf, which is torsion-free. I take my Hardenazimov filtrations, AN, AN minus 1, A1. And then I look where the slope is equal to zero. This part is the torsion-free part in my, sorry, this part is in F. And this part is going to be in T. Okay, so that's the only thing I'm doing. So that's okay. So, but it's non-trivial. We'll see later. At the moment, there is nothing special except the existence of arrhythmia filtration, which is just combinatorics. But now it's come the hard part. So this thing, so I get a category which I call co omega b, which is the tilt. And so let me just give you a small intuition of this category. As I say, there's a category of complexes which only in two non-trivial cohomologies. So they're just two-term complexes. So essentially, are extension of kernel co-kernel. The kernel is in F, the co-kernel is in T. And we'll see later why this category is useful. But now I have to find the Z. And the definition of the Z is slightly unnatural, but we'll try to see later why this might be good. And one sometimes is bad. So the definition is the following. I just take minus the integral of e to the minus b minus square root of minus 1 omega times the Chern character. And so that's my z. So it's a minus integral of x in my new notation, or e minus square root of minus 1 omega times ch beta. Okay, so this is a complex number. What is my lambda in this case? My lambda is the following. It's just what you expect. So it's just h0, direct sum de Neron Severi, direct sum h4. Okay, so that's my lambda in this case. And so the result is the following proposition. The sigma omega b, which is given by the z that I just told you, and the category that is just defined, is a stability condition. Okay, so that's so we improved because rank and degree will never, somehow no function will work on coherent sheaf, but this function does work. Okay, so this gives you some strong inequality, right? Because it's telling you that somehow imaginary part and rank, somehow the rank is the imaginary part. So if the rank is zero, then the degree has to be strictly positive. Okay, so we gained something, and we'll see how to use this thing. And not only that, I have two parameters, and you can imagine the two parameters are nice. So if I look at the map, which goes from omega b, and I'm associating my sigma omega b, this is a continuous map. Okay, and actually it's a parameterization. And then this is not really the right dimension, but if you play a bit with group actions, it's going to give you exactly what you expect somehow. So this is just a slice, but it's actually cover at least an open subset of this tab. Okay, good. So how to prove this proposition? So, good, have time. So the proof of the proposition is the following. We just do what we have to do. I have to tell you what is Q still. So let's try. So we have to prove two things we have to prove. So the first thing you have to prove is that this category is nice. So coherent sheaves is notirian. This category is notirian. This is not really true in general a priori, but it's true in some cases. And here is where the technicality comes. So this omega and b are real. So I need to worry about these things that are real. So the only way to do it, unfortunately, is to first prove it for rational one, and then use this support property to extend by deformation to all. So the first case to prove the proposition, I'm assuming that that omega and b are rational. Okay, so they're rational classes, they're rational divisors. And so the lemma to start with is the following, is that the category at least is notirian, which is good, under these assumptions. Okay, which is good because for existence of other residual filtration, that was the only property we needed, that the category is notirian. Then we have existence automatically. And so that's the first lemma. So how to prove this thing? This thing is proved as follows. Maybe I won't prove it, but it's somehow you have to check what you imagine to check. So you have to check that you prove by directly that every chain actually has to terminate by looking at cohomology sheaves. Okay, so that's... Yeah, if you're interested, I can tell you how to prove it, but it's nothing special somehow, this proof. But the second part is more interesting. So this is the key of the proof. So this is easy somehow, but this part is the hard part. So the part is the following, is that z induces actually a stability in the strong sense. So how to say this thing? We can say as follows, that the z omega b, did I put up higher? If I plug this category, minus zero, this guy is inside the upper half plane union, the negative real line. So this means exactly what we said before. We have a rank, which is the imaginary part. If the rank is zero, the rank is always positive. And if the rank is zero, then the degree is actually strictly positive. Okay, so that's the key argument. and the key part of the proof. That's where the hard part is. And so let's try to prove it. Okay? So far, so good, right? Okay.
What is the key?
Yeah, it's coming. It's coming now. 1 second. It's Bogomolov inequality plus a little twist because you have to worry about it a second. But anyway, I'll show you in a second. So here it is. So proof. So how do I prove it? So the first thing I have to prove that let me write z. I write it as minus the degree plus the square root of minus 1 the rank. So the first thing I have to prove that the rank is positive. So let's write down what is the rank. So the rank by our definition, which I guess is still here, if you just expand this formula here, you get the following equation. So the rank is just omega times C1b. Okay. And now you see what we did, right? Because if you take something in our category here, which unfortunately canceled it, so what did we do? We keep the torsion where it was. And so that's fine. That is not going to affect this function. But the torsion-free part, what did we do? We cut exactly its slope equal to zero. So something which has slope negative, we shifted by one. And so by shifting, we changed the sign in the Grothendieck group. So we make it positive. And the torsion part, we left it where it was, and was positive as well. Okay, so let me just write here. So then R of T omega B, by definition, it's positive. And R of F omega B is actually negative. But since I shifted by one, it becomes positive, right? Because the category co, let me just maybe write here, actually, a second. So this co was F shifted by one and T. OK, so I shift by one. So if I shift by one, I change the sign. And so this means that R of F shifted by 1 is going to be positive. And so the rank is positive. OK, so that's easy. That's by definition. And now let's examine what happens when the rank is 0. So maybe I'll keep the second thing here. So when the rank is 0, what's going on? So I can describe explicitly what happens when rank is equal to 0. So I'm taking an object E in co beta such that the new rank is equal to 0. So what can happen? Okay, so this is a complex, and it can be written as a torsion and torsion free part. This is FE and OK. So what happens? It happens the following thing. So the torsion. Let's look at torsion first. So the torsion was, unfortunately, I canceled the definition. But the torsion has the following property. So these are torsion-free shifts which have slope positive. So those, they cannot have rank 0, because this thing will be positive. So the only thing that in T can have rank 0 are something supporting dimension 0. So this thing can only be a torsion shift supported in dimension 0. So that's the only possibility. And the F part, what can it be? So the F part is the following. So the F part can only be rank 0 if the slope is 0. And the slope of all sub-objects somehow, they have to be strictly smaller than 0. So the only possibility is that this F part can only be torsion-free and semi-stable of slope 0. Okay, so those are the only two possibilities that I have. And, I'm sorry, it's the other way around. Oh, shit. Okay, oops, I'm sorry about this. I wrote this wrong. So this is shift by one. I'm sorry. This is here, this is here. We are in the category already tilted. I'm sorry about that. Okay, so the F is a sheaf, which is torsion-free, semi-stable, and of slope equal to zero. Okay, and now we compute the degree. So what is the degree? So the degree is the following. So it's very special. Yeah, but we are in the tilted category. Sorry, when you're in the tilted category, it's going the other way around, right? So everything can be written as H0 and H minus 1. So the H minus 1 is in F, the H0 is in T. Right, so these are complex which are, it's in the category called beta, right? Mm. Sorry, yeah, before I just mistake that, sorry, yeah. Okay, now we're good. So torsion part is easy. So let's write it. So the degree, what it is? The degree is just CH2B minus omega square over 2 rank. So that's what is the D. Minus. Yeah, that's correct. So how do I do now? I just plug a torsion sheaf. But the torsion is easy. V of a skyscraper is just the CH2 of the skyscraper, which is just 1, which is positive. Good. So these guys all have degree positive. Great. So this part, I don't care so much. Now let's go to this part. So what do I have? I have a semi-stable sheaf of slope 0, and I want to bound the CH2. So that's not a trivial result, but it does exist. And so let me state it, theorem. This is a well-known result about semi-stable sheaves. And this is the inequality that is going to give you the quadratic form. And so what is the inequality? Say the following thing. So this theorem says that if I have F torsion-free sheaf, which is semi-stable, with respect to the slope omega b, that doesn't change anything, it's still the usual stability, then I have the following inequality, that the discriminant of f is positive, where the discriminant is just c1b self-intersection minus 2 rank, ch2b. Okay, so that's the inequality I want. And this theorem is harder, of course. That's a hard theorem. And it's, but that's the only non-trivial result that you're going to use somehow. And then you will see somehow, you just, yeah, we'll see later what happens in general. The B, don't worry so much. This expression is invariant under tensoring, so B you can remove safely, if you want. And this is the usual Bogomolov inequality. And I'm not going to prove it, but maybe if you're interested, I can tell you an idea how to prove it. Sorry? KX. So this is skyscraper sheaf. Sorry. Yeah. So you see where this proof actually goes wrong in dimensions higher than 2 because you have higher objects. So skyscraper sheaf will have, again, D equal to 0. But we'll still be better, actually, than before. OK, so how to use Bogomolov now? Now it's easy. Because now I'm going to do the following thing. I just use Bogomolov and the origin index theorem. And so let me rewrite this inequality. So now what I have something whose rank is 0. So slope omega b of Fe is equal to 0. So this implies the following, that CH2b of Fe is what? Is more or equal. Then the following thing, then C1b squared divided by the rank. And, but the slope is 0, so C1 times omega is 0, so C1 squared is negative by the origin index theorem. Okay. And so I'm good, right? Because now I just plug it inside my D. And so what do I get? I get a D of Fe is equal to CH2B of Fe minus a constant square, which is positive, times the rank, which is positive. And so this is negative by what we saw before. And this is positive, strictly positive, actually, because it's the rank of a torsion-free sheaf. And so this guy is strictly positive. And so when I take the minus, it's going to be strictly negative. And so this quantity, negative, strictly negative, is going to be negative. But our f in the category, again, is not there, but it's shifted by 1. So again, I switch the sign, and so I'm good to go. C1 squared, because I have omega equal to 0. So this means that omega times C1b is equal to 0. And so by Hodge index theorem, if I have a class which pairs with an ample equal to 0, then the square is negative. Okay? And so that's why I'm using this thing here. Okay? So that's the Hodge index theorem. Okay. So how much do I have? 5 minutes. Good. So Q. Q is this one. Okay, so I use Q twice. I use Q to define stability, and now we'll use it to deform stability. But I have to do some slow little annoying thing, which is guy actually does not really positive on all of them, but it's going to be positive if I add a small constant, which takes care of the fact that I have negative curves. But anyway, so this proves that Z is there. Now I have that my category is abelian, so I have almost everything I need. The only thing I need is Q. So now define Q as follows. So I take delta, and I have to worry because a torsion sheaf, which are supported on curves, might have negative delta. So I have to add a small little piece, and I'm sorry about this. So there is a constant, which depends on omega, times omega C1b squared. Okay, and this constant, what it is, this constant, there exists such a constant, which is positive. And this constant is simply saying that if I have a curve which is negative, I can always find the bound from below, given this constant here. I don't want to spend much time about this constant. It's very easy to define, but anyway, since I have no time. In the case in which omega and b are parallel, for example, Picard rank 1, this constant is 0, of course. Okay, so and now we are good to go. So the small theorem is that this guy is positive on all semi-stable objects. So then proposition it says the following thing is that sigma omega b belongs to stab x with the above q. Okay, so this means the following two properties, that Q restricted to the kernel is negative definite, and that's easy to check. And the harder thing is to prove is that if I have something which is semi-stable with respect to this new stability, so it's different stability, then I wanted Q of the semi-stable object to be positive. And that's how you prove it. It's actually a subtle thing, but anyway, maybe I won't have time later. Somehow you have to use again deformation. So you deform B to go toward omega to infinity. And when you go to infinity, you recover Giesecke stability, where you know the theorem is true by Bogomolov theorem. And you can control that at each wall you don't lose any information. So no, that's what happens. I will describe a bit later maybe this thing. But let me finish maybe the proof, and then maybe I'll comment about this proposition in a second. And so now we only did it for B, but once you have Q, you can deform it and prove it for general. So no, now for a general omega and b, what you do, you use q and the form. And so what it means that if I have something non-real, how do I prove that the thing? So I know that the nearby rational is true by this argument. I use this q to prove that somehow if I move nearby, I can control stability somehow. And then I can, and that's somehow how this proof goes somehow. Sorry, I have not so much time to say this thing. But anyway, it's a bit it's a bit technical, but it's not so hard, so no. Yeah, omega, beta, omega, and b, which I see omega. Yeah, c omega is defined. Yeah, let me just define it. Yeah. Yeah. This c is actually depends only. Yeah, it's just. It's just what you expect. So I want c omega times c one b square d square to be plus d square to be positive for all the effective divisor. Sorry, I want to, let me put H here. No, I'm sorry. Shoot. And here I want omega here. Okay, so that's a constant for which this equality is true for all effective divisors. Yeah. And somehow the support property, so it's telling that if I choose some sort of minimally, this is not really continuous, but I don't really care that the Q is continuous. The only thing I care is that it exists. So, and that's I can do locally, and then I can use the formation. Yeah. Okay, but that's the C somehow that I define. Okay, good. I guess I'm out of time, so maybe I'll stop here. Now, the next time, what I want to say, maybe I'll start with this proposition again. So I'll show you what it means to go to a large volume limit, and I'll show you how to recover Giesecke stability. Then I'll show you how to use Q to prove that there is a wall and chamber structure, which is very nice. And then I'm going to talk about moduli spaces and how to test a moduli space to a stability condition, a line bundle on the moduli space, and how to prove that this line bundle is positive on the moduli space. And then we are going to apply this to do something. Okay, so that's the plan. Okay, sorry, thanks.